So welcome back. Welcome to the session of short presentation. For those who we haven't met before, I mean, don't know me, I'm KZ, assistant professor in the Smith School of Business, University of Maryland, College Park. So I'll be hosting this short presentation session. We have six speakers, but we only have less than 1 hour. So for each talk, you only have 5 minutes. And then we're going to have a question and answer session. So when we get to the question and answer session, when you ask questions, please say your name and your affiliation. Okay. So first, let me introduce our speakers. And you know, the chairing a session is not that difficult, but this is the challenge of work for me. You know, I have to speak all the name, full names, and also the affiliations. It's not easy. So let me speak the full names, and if I speak wrong, please correct it when you present, okay? So the first speaker is Daniel Gartner, that's easy, from Carnegie Mellon. And then the second speaker is Mohammed Abdel Hamid, from the University of Buffalo, sorry. And then the third speaker is Patrick Daizi Gamier, from University of KwaZulu-Natal. And then the fourth speaker is Robert Rockman. I mean, I wanna try this. So it's a German. I wanna try this. The KwaZulu Nuam University of Applied Science. And then the fifth speaker is Anton Ivanov from University of Buffalo. And then the last one is easy. Alan Young from Georgia State University. So now, please allow me to ask the first speaker, Daniel Gartner, to present. His work? He's not here?
So actually he's having a baby, or his wife is having a baby.
So you're going to present, right?
Yeah, so I'm going to present for him.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's, okay, go ahead.
Yeah. So this work is actually we started this work in 2011 with me and Dr. Rema Patman, and also with the late Dr. James Levin, who is the who was the chief medical information officer at the Children's Hospital of Pittsburgh. And throughout these years, we have been adding some new developments to the work. So I'm hoping to say a few exciting work that we've been doing since the past year. So the motivation for the work is that there are unintended consequences of using healthcare IT, and specifically in this paper, we're focusing on the excessive physical and cognitive workload that's imposed by the healthcare IT on the physicians. And so our goal is to minimize those physical and cognitive workload for selecting medical orders or just using health IT in general, and hope that our work can give the busy healthcare providers more time to focus on patient care. And the specific context that we chose is order sets. So order set is a critical function of the CPOE systems. And the concept of order sets is like an Amazon bundle. So they bundle the similar and relevant orders together, so that when physicians need to place multiple orders to their patients, they can just place those orders with one or two simple clicks. So they're expected to improve the efficiency by reducing physical and cognitive workloads, and also improve patient safety, because they are supposed to support clinicians to place complex orders and ask physicians to comply with the hospital guidelines. However, what we found from previous data is that physicians are not using the order sets so much, and that the reason is potentially because the order sets are not matched with the current workflow. So the physicians are having to go to the database and choosing a la carte orders. So a la carte orders are the individual orders that are not part of the order sets, and selecting them. And so they end up spending more time in placing medical orders. So the approach that we took is that we're taking an optimization approach. We modeled the medical placement process as an optimization problem, and then we have two solutions. One is heuristic and the other is optimal, and we implemented our methods in a Java platform, and later in the presentation I'm going to show you some preliminary results. So this is the mathematical model. I don't want to overwhelm you with all the variables, but we are trying to minimize, for example, the deselecting of a default on items or default off items, the confirming of orders, and the deselecting of orders. I know this is too much for the 5-minute talk, so I can talk offline if you're interested. And basically, the interesting part is that we're able to minimize the physical workload and the cognitive workload defined in terms of the number of mouse clicks and the information processing time from the current solution. So we tried for different number of these data-driven order sets for K1, 2, and K equals 5. That's the number of order sets. And in each case, we're able to see a reduction in the mouse clicks and the information processing time. And we were also able to find several 9-time intervals where the orders are clustered, more clustered, so that we can develop order sets that are more focused to the specific time interval. So to summarize, we have this mathematical mixed integer programming approach and also a bisecting k-means approach. And in both approach, we're able to have reductions in the objective function. And we have tested our methods on 3 conditions. We've tested it on pneumonia, asthma, and appendectomy. And we were able to get good results throughout across these conditions. So the future work will address more advanced problems and address scalability. So with k-means, we're able to solve a large number of patients, but if we want to solve the problem to optimality, it turns out that it takes a lot of time and we can only solve a few small number of patients. So that's one problem that we're working on. We're also working on fixed time interval solutions, extension for other clinical conditions, and more importantly, we're looking for validation by the clinicians. So that's all the talks today. And if you're interested, I'm happy to give more details after the talk. Thank you.
So let me try it again. The second speaker is Mohammed Abdelhamid. Is that correct?
Yes, almost. Almost as good.
It's right.
Okay. Okay, so today I'll present my joint work with Professor Sharma and Professor Bezwada, which is about protecting patient privacy through empowering them about consent in HIE. So we know that HIE is a system that connects multiple healthcare providers and enables them to share their patient information electronically. There are benefits to HIE, such as reducing medical costs, but there are also drawbacks that cannot be neglected, like privacy and security risk involved. There is also another drawback that we found by collecting consent forms of HIEs across 17 states. We found that most HIEs provide only binary sharing decision, either share everything with everyone or nothing at all. So there is no flexibility granted to patients. So we tried to ask and answer two main questions. The first one is, how does a more holistic education, as opposed to a one-sided message, impact patient intention to consent? And by two-sided, I mean a message that has both the drawbacks and the benefits. Another question, since HIEs only provide those rigid binary options, we wonder what happens, how does the impact of the message change if we change the sharing settings? So we divide or we measure our dependent variable, which is a semantic differential intention to consent, 4 times, starting from a binary decision, binary sharing setting, all the way to a fully customized sharing settings where patient can choose what information to share and with who. Our motivation comes from our recognition that patients are heterogeneous. They have different privacy concerns and different level of trust and different health conditions. Therefore, the policies and mechanisms in place for information sharing should reflect those variations. It shouldn't be one size fits all, like the current case. So what we do, we conduct an experimental survey where we measure patients' intention to consent under the four different settings, and then we randomly assign them to one of the three video messages that we shoot ourselves professionally. One is the one-sided message, the two-sided message, and a placebo. Then we remeasure those intentions under the four settings, and we see how the impact change. We make sure that the messages are comparable. So for example, they have similar complexity level and readability level so that the difference in the structure does not drive the change. The results are, I think, quite interesting. First, we find that the one-sided message has a positive and significant impact under all flexible sharing settings, but not under the binary sharing setting. Also, we found that the binary, the rigid sharing setting, was the least favorable, while the most flexible was the most favorable. That perhaps says, under rigid consent options, even the most persuasive message does not work. We find no impact for the two-sided message. And overall, we think that this provides practical implications to policymakers. So if you want to increase patient consent, if you want to increase the rate, perhaps you should make the consent process more flexible for patients so that it benefits them more. We think also a more educated patient will be able to choose the right choice for his or herself. And that's it for me. I still have 46 seconds more. Thank you.
So the third speaker is Patrick Daizi Gamie.
Thank you very much. It's really a great honor to be here and to be able to share some of the findings of my work. Just to give you a bit about background of my research, actually, you know, I looked at the whole MS adoption, and I particularly chose my country, which is Burundi, by the way. And by the time I started my research, actually, there was no mHealth at all. There was no mHealth intervention, nothing. But so far, there's only one pilot study that is being done now in the country. And basically, there's no... the pilot study hasn't gone far because of the what's going on in the country now. So, basically, just to summarize what my research entailed, the whole PhD research that I'm doing, it basically looks at how can you introduce mHealth in Burundi to deal with disease management and prevention, basically. Okay, so the country, basically, if you look at the country, Burundi is it's number four now and amongst the poorest country in the world. And as I said, there's only one mHealth initiative in policy phase. And actually, this is in contrast with other countries within the same area, which is the Great Lakes region or the East African community. Because all other countries within East African community, actually, they have adopted mHealth, but Burundi hasn't really. And the country faces so many health problems, and that actually has to do with the lack of accurate information and that can be delivered on timely, in a timely manner to enable decision-making. And that actually makes decision-making in the health sector basically very, very difficult. Okay, so now, in this presentation, what I'm looking at, I'm specifically focusing on impediments or factors that inhibit the adoption of mHealth in Burundi. So what I did, actually, I looked at mHealth capabilities and I tried to create one single score that can represent mHealth capabilities. Okay, so that ranged from SMS-based awareness programs, okay, and by using mobile devices for treatment support. Okay, so eight variables that I tried to put together to create one single score for mHealth capabilities, and I basically run a correlation between impediments and that score for mHealth capability to see where there's any influence that can emanate from the impediments to the adoption of mHealth capabilities. And basically, the last point is that I'll use a case study from the Rwandan adoption, mHealth adoption, and to see what lesson can we learn in terms of implementing mHealth in Burundi. So, I conducted a survey of 212 healthcare professionals in 48 primary healthcare centers, and basically I used principal component analysis to generate the single score for mHealth capabilities adoption in Burundi. And then I ran a Pearson correlation between impediments and the mHealth capabilities, and I did a regression model. Okay. So findings basically, 51.2 acceptance level of mHealth capabilities, okay? And the impediments, basically, we found that, okay, if I can just go to this slide here. Oh, okay, that's the next one, okay. Right, we found that the impediments were, the primary healthcare professionals, actually, they acknowledge that these are the impediments to mHealth adoption. But if you look at the correlation between impediments and mHealth capabilities, actually what I found very interesting was there's a positive correlation. In fact, I was expecting a negative correlation. I thought maybe the perception of these factors as impediments could actually generate a decrease in mHealth capabilities acceptance, but that's not the case. So basically what it means is that these factors actually have little impact on the adoption of mHealth capabilities. Okay. So then I did a separate stepwise regression analysis where I excluded all the variables, or I tested one variable at a time to see which one actually fits within the regression model. And the first impediment, lack of skills, basically is the one that fits within the model. Okay. Now, if you look at the case of Rwandan adoption of mHealth, I use Rwanda because Rwanda has almost similar historical background as Burundi. What made their mHealth adoption successful is that they forged partnership with mobile operators, which made it very simple for them to adopt, to scale the mHealth adoption intervention. They also involved users in the design phase. Also, they used performance-based rewards, okay? And also, they were equipped with enough logistics to deal with the increase in the demands of mHealth intervention. So these are some of the things that can actually influence or guide the implementation of mHealth adoption within the country. Thank you very much.
Our next speaker is Robert Rockman.
Okay. Thanks. So in Germany it is called Hochschule Neu-Ulm, but we think we can stick with the equivalent of University of Applied Sciences Neu-Ulm in Germany. So thanks for giving me the great opportunity to present a part of my ongoing research project. I'm a research assistant in my first year, and I'm concerned with the e-health adoption of elderly individuals, and this is one piece of it, and it's precisely on the effect of previous work experience on the e-health adoption of elderly. To give you a small background, in Germany we are confronted with the demographic change, people getting older and older, and it puts a tremendous economic pressure on our healthcare system since diseases usually increase with age. On the other hand, as we have seen it already, we are faced with a constant evolution in the sector of e-health, such as mobile apps or smartwatches that aim to assist individuals in supporting to take active control of their health and well-being. However, what is one challenge of the e-health adoption of elderly people? It's called the digital capability divide, which basically reflects differences in skill levels of being able to use a computer. This issue is not only a matter of younger versus older individuals, but likely also an issue between the elderly itself. So the elderly could not really be considered as a homogeneous group. There are some individuals or elderly that are more being able to use a computer than others. Within the research, we have a quite related concept. It is called computer self-efficacy that basically reflects individuals' judgments of being able to use a computer. And we found in recent research that computer self-efficacy is the key predictor of the internet and use adoption of elderly individuals. Therefore, the first question we would like to ask in our research is whether internet self-efficacy of older adults affect the e-health adoption decision. And since we have seen that computer self-efficacy is quite of importance, we have also seen or noticed that really little is known how specifically computer self-efficacy is shaped among elderly individuals. So one potential factor might be whether they gained experience with the internet and computers during their work life, or more or less, did they had access and use of the internet before they got retired. We have seen a related research in the context on school versus home IT access, that having access in a more school-related setting has a quite tremendous effect. And therefore, we would like to pose the second research question, whether prior occupational internet usage also affects the internet self-efficacy of older adults. Coming to our research model, I think it's quite basic and straightforward. Intention to use e-health is commonly determined by the factors of outcome or usefulness expectations, as well as of effort or perceived ease of use expectations, as well as internet self-efficacy. Based on established research, we also hypothesize that internet self-efficacy will affect their outcome as well as effort expectations. And as I already mentioned, we hypothesize that past work internet usage is a determinant, and that the duration of being retired weakens that relationship. At this moment, we are in progress of conducting a quantitative study among people age 65 and above. Our measurement is obviously adapted and derived from established measurement concepts. And at this moment, we have about 51 collected data sets, allowing us to do a preliminary analysis, which I would like to present you now. So here we go. Our model is able to explain about 40% of the variance, and what we can see is that indeed effort expectations are the primary determinant, and which is in turn determined by their internet self-efficacy. So at this moment we can somehow state that the e-health adoption is indeed a skill level issue. And now the interesting part is that past work internet usage indeed is a significant antecedent of their internet self-efficacy of older adults. Coming to some more obvious findings then, what can we say is that past work internet usage as such indirectly contributes to the e-health adoption of elderly individuals. What is quite interestingly is that the relationship between prior use at the workplace and their internet self-efficacy is relatively stable. What does it actually mean? We have the absence of the moderating effect of being retired. As such, we can say that is a long-term effect. Once they gained experience at the workplace, they have a relatively stable internet self-efficacy. The absence of the internet self-efficacy direct effects will be a next step of our ongoing research. We have to reconsider some cases, use cases, and we will also increase the sample size. All right, that's it. Thank you a million, and looking forward to a nice discussion with you.
Next speaker is Anton Ivanov.
Hello, everybody. My name is Anton Ivanov. I'm a fourth-year PhD candidate from University of Buffalo. I'm working with Professors Red Sharman and Ramos Wada. Today, I'm presenting our latest study that examines the impact of online ratings and reviews on the new patient referrals. In the United States healthcare system, patient referrals play a central role, serving two important purposes. One, evaluating healthcare provider performance, and two, shaping the business value, as loss of patients may negatively impact the generated income. Although a variety of factors impacting referrals have been studied over decades, little attention has been given to those surfacing from the internet. In particular, with the rise of the consumerist movement, there are many online sources offering doctor ratings and reviews left by prior patients. Notably, even though many intuitively assume positive influence of ratings and reviews on the business outcomes, there are others who are quite skeptical about these user-generated measures, considering them biased and not representative of actual quality or performance. To address this discrepancy, we conducted a longitudinal study of of the 1,700 oncologists in the United States. Additionally, drawing on prior literature, we examined the impact of oncologists' referral network, their academic prominence, and also the distance between the referred oncologists and the referring physicians. Further, to guide our hypothesis development and provide rationale for the impact of online ratings on the referrals, we employed signaling theory, which is fundamentally concerned with reducing information asymmetry between two parties that have access to different information. Furthermore, to provide rationale for the impact of prior patient reviews on the referrals, we extended our theoretical framework by adapting the agenda setting theory and its core proposition of the salience in the media influencing public opinion. To test our hypothesis, we collected data from several publicly available sources: CMS, Vitals.com, HealthGrades, and National Provider Registry. The resulting data set consisted of 1,700 oncologists observed in the United States, observed from 2009 to 2013. Note that to address the issue of the so-called J-shaped distribution in the rating scores, we dichotomized the original Vitals 1 through 5 rating scores into binary rating status, 5-star or otherwise. What's more, we employed text mining and concept mapping to determine the key themes emerged from the user reviews, namely interpersonal manners, knowledge, and facility and staff, which we combined into system. Also, in addition to that, we were able to determine the sentiment associated with both the emerged themes and the oncologist reviews. When dealing with ratings and reviews, one faces a problem of unbiased estimation due to endogeneity resulting from the omitted confounders. To correct for that, we employed instrumental variable approach and also instrument-free Liebel's procedure. Our estimates obtained through two-stage predictor substitution supported all of the hypotheses of the study, therefore eliminating the significant influence of the binary rating status and also topics discussed in the reviews on the referral count. To conclude, our findings suggest that obtaining and maintaining a 5-star status positively impacts the referral count over time, increasing it by approximately 8%. Also, monitoring and moderation of the user reviews are highly recommended, as those with negatively impact the referral count. Overall, we suggest that online engagement through physician rating platforms that provide user-generated measures sounds like a good bang for the buck. Thank you for your attention.
We're getting to the last talk from Alan Young.
Hello, everybody. My name is Alan Yang, and I'm here from Georgia State University. I just want to take this opportunity to thank my advisor, Dr. Ukar Varshney, sitting right there, who not only is gracious enough to work with me, but was willing to drive me here to the conference and back to Atlanta. thank you very much. So the research question that we are interested in is, what type of financial incentive is effective for improving medication adherence in patients? And if adherence rates are improved, in what conditions and for how long? Now, what we are very interested in is ensuring that patients who have been prescribed medication take their medicine in both the correct amount and on time, specifically the field of medication adherence. And many incentives have been proposed to improve these measures. But specifically, financial incentives are meant to provide some form of monetary compensation or bonus to patients who adhere to their medication schedules. And administration of this incentive could be made possible through some kind of mobile application, which is what I was very interested in the mHealth panel earlier today. And we've tried to coin this acronym of Financial Incentives for Medication Adherence, or FEMA for short. We created a simulation to model cost effectiveness, I'll elaborate more on the reasons for why in the discussion of the results and limitations. And we based most of the variables that we input into the simulation from various sources and literature in the healthcare environment, both based off of medication adherence and papers that are working on financial incentives for medication adherence. Here are some of the papers of diabetes and HIV, and we chose these two diseases. We originally just simply focused on diabetes, but we thought that there is a clear distinction between medication adherence rates for acute conditions and then chronic conditions. And while we understand that diabetes and HIV are not representative of all of those different types of diseases, we thought that was a good starting point, and it was manageable for the beginning of our simulation. So here is a variable input table that we used in order to distinguish between the differences for the different diseases, as well as different rates for the sickness of the patient, and we varied a number of different factors. You'll notice, unfortunately it was a little small, but some of the major variables are hospitalization rate, the dates, the number of days that patients were hospitalized, and then when moving towards the monetary side of things, we evaluated nurse salaries, cost, average cost per day for hospitalization per patient, and then development of an application, and also the cost of the medication. Those are some of the major things that were different between HIV and diabetes evaluation. Now, what we proposed as our financial incentive was a percentage of the patient income, and I know this raises a lot of ethical concerns if this was an actual field study, but we did this in order to try to evaluate if this would be an effective, because the idea of this was that if a patient is receiving, say, a statistic 10% of their income, as you'll notice on the bottom, we have we varied from 5 to 20%, then they're more likely to change their behavior. And there can be more work done on this later on. So here are some of our results in a return on investment table. Just from some of the assumptions, we evaluate percentage of income for the intervention at 20%. We've calculated or estimated nurse salaries at $60 an hour. And then we had set baseline adherence rates at 60% and modeled improvement from this application of FEMA at 15%. And so you'll see here that there's a few things going on. First is the lower patient income, naturally ROI tends to increase. And then as the number of patients increases for the distribution of the intervention, ROI also consistently increases. And then based on our model, the further up you move in patient income, the less successful FEMA is. These are the results for HIV cases. You'll notice that they're significantly worse compared to diabetes cases, and I'll elaborate a little bit why in this discussion of the results. So some of the reasons we found was the higher cost of HIV medication, and more specifically that what is considered adherent in the medication adherence literature between these two diseases. For diabetes, around 80% to 100% adherence to the schedule is considered adherent, and you'll see the benefits occurring within lower hospitalization rate, lower length of stay. But for HIV and other acute conditions, the rate tends to be at least above 90% or above 95% or higher. So it's harder for patients to hit that rate of adherence that starts to generate the return on investment. Larger hospitals in general have higher ROI, and some of the limitations of this study. There's limited field studies that exist measuring the effectiveness of financial incentives, specifically on patient behaviors. There are a few, but even fewer still, that specifically measure medication adherence. We tried to take an aggregate of existing field studies and calculate at 14%, but there's still a lot of work to be done. As you notice, that the citation is from 97. And finally, we think that these estimates can be a little bit broad, and we want to try to get as much data as possible, and any suggestions to that end would be very helpful. Thank you.
So now we have about 10 minutes for questions. And also, please say your name and your affiliation when you ask questions.
Hi, I'm John Barras, University of Maryland. So I have a question about privacy. We have technology today available, which some of you use, that we can actually have differentiated privacy. So we have different degrees of sharing between the data. So if we adopt this for electronic records, you think that adoption will increase or not? And that's very easy for users to do, right? I can define a priori what I'm willing to share and with whom. And right. Then I can repeat that process until we agree on a model and then see what happens.
Right. So
it doesn't have to be, in other words, Boolean. Zero or one.
So based on the results, we see that flexible options actually increase consent rates. That's what our results showed.
Yeah. But I'm surprised that you say that the hospitals or the medical practices are not using this differentiated privacy, because I know in Massachusetts,
in
Massachusetts Information Highway, they do that.
Okay, so we collected 52 consent forms from 17 states that adopt the opt-in model. So there are states that adopt opt-out and opt-in. Most of them, so some of them, about nine HIEs, have degree of granularity, like share all and then share all except this provider and then share nothing except this provider. That is the maximum level of granularity we found. But for the most part, most HIEs provide only those binary decisions. So there are some that provide some type of flexibility, but not all of them, not most of them even. It's only a few of them, handful of them. Okay. And we collected those forms online. Those that we did not find, we called, we emailed. We managed to only do 52 in 17 states.
We may have a technology problem that they don't know about this technology. I do not know. I mean, to me, it's a surprise that it's not.
It's quite surprising. Although the patient is supposed to be the main beneficiary from this system, the reality shows it's not the patient, it's mostly the providers. Even when they say it reduces cost for the provider, but it does not reduce cost for the patient. The insurance price does not go down. You pay the same thing. It's only the provider that saves money, not the patient.
I have a question for Robert. Again, it's a technology question. When we talk about prior experience for computer or internet, this is rapidly going away. Because currently we are developing, and things exist, that the moment you show your face in your computer, it starts recognizing you and puts up a voice dialogue, and you can actually communicate with anybody you want as if you were there. There's nothing required to enter, nothing required to search, nothing to do of that sort of thing. Will this help in this study? Or how much of this kind of more advanced technology was included in your study?
That's a good question. Well, obviously, as far as I understand, one part of your question is how did I measure the previous work experience or internet experience, to be more precise, is what's measured in terms of intensity and frequency. So the first part is how often did they use, for instance, once a month or at least every day. And the intensity measure is the duration of the use. So of course it's self-reported, and these both together form internet experience.
But what type of experience you tested? Like somebody has to go and type something and look for?
No, just how often did they access the internet before?
But what I'm addressing is how you access it, okay? Because quite often with older people, because of various measures, even dexterity measures, they have difficulty in typing and things like that.
It's a really good point, and I think this is one what we are currently considering. How could we enhance that construct? In mind, at this stage, it's quite trivial or too simple just to measure it as a time-related construct. Obviously, that's the next step we are considering, and it's
pretty much
very nice feedback.
Pretty much this technology is going to come to your iPhones. So you basically take your iPhone, you look at it, and you can start talking to your doctor or whoever very quickly.
Thank you.
Pasha Ray from Simon Business School, University of Rochester. I have a question for Anton. Very interesting study. I always want to study something about a physical referral. The first two questions I have for you are clarification. First, can you explain a little bit about your dependent variable?
So we obtained our dependent variable from Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services. It provides, it's a publicly available data set which provides the pattern of the referrals between the referring physicians, could be primary care physicians and specialists, and the second party.
So it's like a binary variable, whether it's...
No, it's more like social network data with IDs of the referring physicians and the referred physician. So we were able to run some analysis and match those.
Okay, so, but in your study, how do you operationalize? Did you use like boundary? I think I remember.
We use the total number of new patient referrals in a given year.
Okay, it's count.
For a given oncologist, yes.
Okay, so it's basically count variable.
Correct, it's a count variable. Okay. That's why we employed Poisson regression.
Okay, so have you tried to like look at the trying like negative binomial to see if it?
There is an interesting point here. You see, negative binomial regression and Poisson regression, they're very similar, with only difference that negative binomial is employed when you have an over-dispersion parameter of higher than 1.
That's for the Poisson, right?
No, that's for the negative binomial. And you also have to meet two conditions. However, according to the recent research, Poisson estimator is completely robust to any type of over-dispersion and also to the autocorrelation in the dependent variable, which we also observed in our study. Okay. So I hope that answers the question, and Poisson regression is the way to go.
Okay, well, I'm not sure about that, but we can definitely talk offline.
Or so, I can provide you with some invaluable citations.
Yeah, my second question about your IV choice, can you explain a little more about the IV that you used to address it?
We did a comprehensive literature review, and we came up with a whole variety of factors at different levels, patient level factors, physician level factors, facility, I mean, a hospital or healthcare provider factors, and many of them have been cited over decades. Within those, we try to extract the most interesting and most relevant to our study. And another important component is that note that we have a panel of 5 years. So we had to have an opportunity to be able to collect that data from multiple sources for the given years. Not okay. To have, you know, any missing values across years. And for that reason, there is a certain limitation imposed on the selection of the IVs because not everything is possible for collection today.
Okay, yeah.
At least from free sources.
Yeah, we can talk about the testing of IV stuff like offline. Thanks.
Yes, I have a question and two comments for Mohammed. First, there's a security principle of least privilege where you only provide as much information to somebody to do his job, right? That's the least privilege and no extra at any, and only at the times needed. The second, so that was the comment. And the question is that you've observed 43 different HIEs have
52
out of which 9 right. And 43 are the HIE, different HIEs that provide binary or in emergency only. Now, I wanted you to say, the HIPAA law, can you correct me on this? The HIPAA law, the way it is written, provides this loophole.
So there is one thing also I did. I analyzed HIPAA privacy laws, privacy rule, and also investigated the privacy rules of 17 states. So HIPAA is the bigger umbrella, and it allows states to choose opt-in and or opt-out consent option. So opt-in automatically by default you are your information is shared unless you say no. Opt-in, they have to ask you. So that's where the binary comes. Then it also allows the states to choose how they develop their consent option. So they have complete flexibility on whether they put two binary options or 4 or 5 or 6, so it's completely up to the healthcare providers. And here comes the discrepancy. You find most states choose the opt-out because it's the easier way out. Then 17 states only choose opt-in. And out of those, because healthcare providers have that flexibility, they choose also the easier way out. They just choose yes or no. So if we manage to enforce laws on healthcare providers to provide those more flexible options, then they will have to do it, and then the system will be more beneficiary for the patient. So it was the HIPAA, the variation in HIPAA law that drove these motivations.
So your research is really going to address that loophole in the way the policy
is written. Right. So of course I didn't have time in 5 minutes to explore. I have about 17 slides in only the variation in HIPAA laws and also the 52 forms, by the way, just to say it. I analyzed them form by form. So I have about 7 or 8 categories for each form where I put whether this is mentioned on the form or not. So for example, only one form out of all 52 addressed privacy concerns. The other do not say anything about the privacy problems.
All right, due to a time limit, so if you still have questions, you can talk during the lunch. And then we have last question.
Raymond Wei from the NLM, National Institutes of Health. This one, first question is for Patrick, Mobile Health. I saw that you said that skills are very important, skills development and the lack of personnel in developing countries for mobile health interventions, where there's a lot of business opportunities and where mHealth has a lot of potential for inciting change in clinical care. But from the results of what you presented, where the skills needs from a provider side, from the computer development side, or is it from everything, like including the... So there's a lack. Is there a lack of skills of the physicians, of the developers, and of the health workers, or?
No, it's actually lack of skills to develop mHealth applications.
All right.
Yeah, sorry, I didn't actually specify that. Yes, that was the one that was significant.
I see.
Amongst all the impediments, yes.
Interesting. And second question is for Alan. Great idea with the FEMA. I can imagine it working. I mean, if I had to take an antibiotic and I get money for just taking it perfectly, then that would be great. There's a lot of investment in medication adherence, especially for addressing antibiotic resistance, for hypertension control to prevent CHF and cardiovascular diseases. In your modeling, did you see a particular price on how much patients would get? Is there like a threshold that for high-income patients, they would probably be more accepting if, you know, you give them $100 if they finish their course of treatment, and for lower-income patients, you know, maybe like $1 a day would work, something like that.
Yeah, and this speaks to some of the ethical concerns of if we actually wanted to try this with a field study, because the idea is that we want to achieve that sweet spot where we have patients who regardless of how much they make, but the fact of the matter is that someone who's making, say, $200,000 a year is not going to be that heavily influenced, or the idea is that they're not going to be that heavily influenced by a $5 incentive for taking their medication. They would just ideally gloss over it. But we took 10% as a starting point, and there's been a lot of research now and regarding application of financial incentives, not specifically for medication adherence, but to promote healthy behavior. So if you're more interested in this topic, I recommend Volpe and Lowenstein. Their work in 2008 and recently in 2015, they worked on trying to cessate smoking while providing financial incentives to people. And they found that a flat rate, and they monitored different ways. They provided vouchers, they provided a lottery system, or just a flat payment. And they evaluated specifically which of these is more effective. And it turns out that just giving people cash, like a bill immediately, is the most effective, but it's only in the short term. I couldn't go into the details of long-term adherence regarding financial incentives, but the fact is that this type of incentive improves short-term adherence regardless of the monetary amount that's provided. But in the long term, the results are not very well studied. Very few studies of financial incentives go beyond 6 months or 1 year. And those that do have seen a negative effect. At first, adherence will increase, but patients come to expect, you know, some kind of reward for taking their medication beyond simply being healthier. And so later on, they find that medication decreases again. So I think there's a lot to talk about, and thank you very much for your question.
All right, let's give a big applause to these speakers.